everybody. I'm Wojciech, Biela, and Karol, Sobczak, my colleague here in the Swiss and the middle. And we come to you from our regional office in Warsaw, with Starburst, one of the co-founders. And so in this presentation, I'll briefly introduce ourselves, tell you about Presto, also briefly, and then I'll let Karol dive into the CBO and specifics how we designed it, why we designed it, and tell you about what we are doing on that for Presto in this field. As I said, we come to you from Starburst. It's a Boston-based company founded by a group of designers to Presto. We have over 4 years of our activity in the project. As a company, we offer distribution of Presto, both for on-prem and for different cloud environments, public clouds. We support a lot of customers in natural production environments and offer additional components to Presto in our offering. So, to be in that position, we, like I said, we have over 4 years of contributions to Presto. During that time, there was a plethora of topics that we worked on. The notable features are a lot of SQL advancements, which allow Presto to complete CBO queries out of the box. Corpus optimizer, which allows those queries to perform well, so they exist, built integration tools for execution engine improvements as well. With this distribution, we help customers on prem through different deployments of Presto, whether that's the access tools, access different things that we're described, and this is why we study Presto as a SQL on anything as opposed to just SQL on Hadoop, which is a very important feature of Presto, is the ability to query basically any open source. Different objects, storages, NoSQL data storage, there's traditional RDBMS, there's Hadoop, obviously. So this is one of the applications, and also in the cloud, we are present and we have customers using our offering in AWS, and Azure, Google Cloud. And recently, we switched the control to more help manage the clusters in public clouds. So, what is Presto itself? So, first of all, it's a database engine that is a SQL engine that is used by a lot of companies. Most of them use it now. It's just a subgroup of the most recognizable brands. Many of those are our customers. About some of those are able to talk. I'll just briefly mention out of just do a couple in a moment. So why do they use Presto? Well, there are a couple factors to do it. Presto is open source, so it's a community driven project. It was developed from scratch, and the fundamental design decisions were around the fact that it needs to be a high performance ISO engine with very high concurrency and scalability. It was a replacement project for my inside Facebook, so that's why I needed to address some things that I had around those topics. And it embraces the separation of compute and storage, right? It's a very important paradigm recently, and allows you to scale all collections very well. And furthermore, Presto doesn't block you. So with the ability to query any data source, you're not bound to any storage. With the ability to figure out how to use storage, you're not bound to any distribution of it. And you can run it in the cloud, in any cloud, on-prem, any hybrid setup. So gives you a lot of freedom there of choice. So the biggest users of Presto, I'll just mention briefly. So Facebook is the largest user of Presto. They have thousands of nodes online all the time, running Presto, scanning over hundreds of terabytes of their data in HDFS. They have other deployments of Presto. For example, they are perhaps the biggest, they have the biggest MySQL cluster, I think, in the world, part of MySQL. They have Presto spread over that as well. Queries over MySQL sites. So this is an application of Presto where they don't use it with Hadoop, so it's a SQL on MySQL. And they have mixed deployments where they have SQL over a couple of data sources in one cluster. With very high concurrency, you have hundreds of users at the same time. Netflix had a very different setup, and they were one of the early users of Presto, so they enjoyed their picture too. They had all their infrastructure outsourced outside and in AWS for a while. Facebook has everything on prem. Their data centers, Netflix runs Presto on EC2. Stores data in S3, and then use podcasts with their data format, where Facebook uses OSC. So you can see that with those completely different infrastructure setups, they still use the same tool. So that's why Presto evolved over time to be a very robust technology. And proven at a really large scale. Uber joined the group a little later, but still they're one of the really notable users. They also contributed a lot of functionality around geospatial analysis. And once they did that, a couple other companies Karol mentioned that there are different strategies for Presto and all of them are working and valid, so there are different ups and downs, but Presto can be installed on separate machines alongside NGFS nodes. It can be installed on the NGFS nodes or subset of them usually with the NGFS cluster is large, or it can be installed on the separate nodes but in some routes. So it's the last scenario is for the very large players that have their own data centers like Facebook, they use this, but Presto is able to take advantage of knowledge about the fact that some data nodes are together and with some workers and schedules for work appropriately to minimize interact communication. So out of those three, the most recommended one would be separate nodes, but and with that, I would hand over to Karol for the more interesting CBO part.
My name is Sobczak, and I'm one of the co-authors of the CBO in Presto. So, to pick up, Presto is a in-memory digital processing engine. It's called using factorization, and for the performance of the task of query execution, it will actually compile by itself to the interpretation of a fact. Presto has a dedicated high performance readers for OSP and particular high performance that also took advantage of the terminal storage format of the file and data files. Presto is also capable of putting down data. And since last year, Presto has a confidence optimizer, which is constantly improved. So when the CBO first landed, it only had support for the statistics in a 5.5 megastore. And the main goals of the CBO were that we that joins could be optimized automatically. So, we would like to compile the join factories to be reordered according to the test, so that the most efficient plan is chosen. Also, for individual join modes, we would like to be able to automatically determine if the join should be partitioned or broadcasted. And we also want to flip the join size if it happens that flipping the size would be beneficial for the cost of the plan. So we utilize table statistics from the Hotmap store, and those are the raw numbers. But we also utilize tone statistics. The meta score and this includes the distinct value for number of distinct values for a column, and this is especially important for estimating the cardinality of the time nodes. We also take into account the fraction of the mean values for a column. We also take account of the mean max distance. So when we are doing the filter estimation, cardinality estimation, we take into account the length. Based on the statistics, we evaluate we estimate the row number and the border column statistics for each time node. And having the statistic estimates, we can actually compute the cost of the plan. And cost can be explained, cost is explained in two factors. One is the CPU cost, the other one is the peak memory of the query during the entire timeline of the query, and also we estimate the network error having the cost, we can compare the price. It is possible to adjust the weight on the cost so that if some users want for the price to be more cost, more efficient, we can send it to you. So here we got an example where CBO helps a lot. So in data warehousing, you often have price signals where the back table is extremely large and the dimension tables are really small. In that case, it doesn't make sense to rehash the large table, the back table on the entire cluster. It makes much more sense to broadcast a small dimension table. And then it's very hard for the network to pass on CPU. So, with CPU, you can write your queries without taking care in which order you run the language to be automatically improved. Another typical example is when you have two tables, two connected tables, but none of them can actually fit into the node's memory. And in this case, both tables need to be rehashed to recycle the faster node. However, one of the tables will be trapped in memory so that you can jump against it. And it should be the small table. So if you write a join that where the initially small table is not the built table that is kept in memory, CBO will automatically receive size and keep the smaller table in memory. Another example here is that you can see that how actually the CBO works, right? So CBO will estimate the cardinality of its download, and based on the cardinality, it will compute the time cost. Right? So when you add a filter to the query, CBO will estimate the outcome accordingly, and adding such filter can completely change the way how a plan is executed finally. So in this case, adding a filter over the line item table caused the cardinality estimation to be much lower and the entire join to be recycled this way. We did extensive benchmarks of Presto with CBO and without CBO. And initially, CBO was part of the Starburst Presto, then now it's also part of the Meetup Presto. But when we benchmarked CBO against the Biela Presto at the time, you could see that the gains are extreme. So the benchmarks here are based on the CBS queries, which are not optimized out of box for the current time. So you get a huge impact, a huge improvement. We also compared, we went ahead and also did benchmarks on the cost of running Starburst Presto versus, or let's say, one of the competitors, which is the EMR Presto. And on average, and this was done also using the CBS grade offset, and on average, the improvement was 7 times better than the EMR Presto. EMR Presto also had problems with finishing a large portion of the queries on a compiler cluster. So the user experience was very good in EMR Presto. Yeah, and you can see that running with Starburst Presto over Biela Presto, it makes you, it's just cheaper, right? If you take fast into account, it can be smaller cluster, or you can have larger concurrency on the cluster, or you can run larger queries. So, of course, we have not stopped there, and we are constantly improving the CBO. So since CBO first landed, we have added a lot of additional features. New plan nodes are semi-join will also have an automatic join type selection. There's also a feature to add the broadcast of the size, and this is particularly important if you have a multi-tenant cluster and want to utilize the memory buffer so that more users can load queries. Also, I believe that the biggest gains from the broadcast join my rate of the cases where it helps is where the which could be recognized by the most really small. So we also improved the peak memory estimation. So previously, Presto wasn't taking into account how the plan is executed. So when you have a join, you first need to collect the data for the peak table that is kept in the memory. And then you can run the actual join, and now the estimation takes that into account. There is a big feature which is native to the Presto, so you don't need to use for something like BML plus to analyze the data. And also, it's interesting, Presto has much better estimation than the BML and much more accurate, especially in a situation where you have inverted values. We also have a software for blue column statistics, so those are supported in the data set for blue, but blue provides only table statistics, which are not enough to do with sophisticated crafting of the plans. So we have extended that and support column statistics. So you can actually use on the other way, you can actually use blue as a pretty good replacement for Presto. What's next? There's a lot of really nice features down the road. We are working on implementing statistics for everything that's been offered. Difficult to estimate the number of different values for all of the partitions that they can interact with are being part of the query. So the idea here is that we can utilize an algorithm called hyperlog log, and this algorithm is used to evaluate the number of distinct values in a continuous stream. And this algorithm has a nice feature that it can store intermediate features. And you can merge the intermediate results to the final count of the number of distinct values. And then the idea is that we will extend the hyperlog statistics with hyperlog intermediate calculate, also for blue. We also have plans to implement statistics for non-CBO calculus. And apart from CBO, there is a tool client, the core itself. So, soon connectors will be able to participate in more sophisticated design. It will be possible to put down links, applications, joint integrations, connectors. Down the road, there is a plan so that connectors can actually participate in optimization, adding home rules for optimizer. The big issue with the cost model right now is that it is really good. So when you run your cluster, if as a particular hardware, you run the request on particular on data with cluster profile. And a rigid cost model is not perfect here. So the idea is that we can collect the performance of estimates during the some time lag and then apply the cost model using some statistical techniques like regression to fit the actual execution statistics better. So this way, CBO can get smarter along the way and optimize it for it better. There is a plan to introduce the text, and text will allow us to represent more sophisticated features of the plan. So currently, again, Reordering doesn't require taking into account the partitioning of the data. So with chance it could get more clever. There is a plan to add a late materialization to the campaign. So Presto does support late latency pages, latency data sources, but it's only for the professional filtering. And with late materialization, it will be also for objects like and so forth. This could improve the performance for a large set of queries. Adaptive optimization. So when you are running a query, it is possible to provide the data as it goes and change the plan along the way. And so you can have a Python aggregation. But then as you go with the query, you figure out that the partial aggregation doesn't have a lot, so you can simply split it at some time. So this is the roadmap. For user information, you can go to there is a lot of blog posts about Presto recently, how it compares to other databases. I recommend reading more about it.
I encourage you both when you find out about Presto to both read our blog on the Starburst data. We cover a lot of Presto details there, both the CBO, different aspects of it, more in depth. And integrations with different systems. Please subscribe to our newsletter watch our Twitter for announcements. Join the Presto SQL Slack, user mailing list, and like the community. With that, I would like to thank you all.
Thanks, Wojciech and Karol. Let me try to tell you once more with the sketch box. So I started working with Kafka also. How do you connect with Kafka streaming? What's the use case of Kafka streaming?
Presto Kafka connector doesn't exploit this streaming part of Kafka. There are many benchmarks with many different
I'm not sure, but I think on the if you Google, you definitely find some recent benchmarks. One of the links here might actually be the
first one. Yeah. So with to be precise, not Spark, but Spark SQL, right? When you're comparing to Spark, be sure to compare it with other kinds of situations.
very interesting. So I just wanted to ask, like, what is the preferred sentiment that these customers like Uber or Twitter or Uber or like Airbnb or whatever are using? Because what I have used with the limited data set that we have, and maybe not in petabytes, I thought it was roughly or something like that. But what these guys are using, if you can get some insight into that, and what is the preferred for the larger data set? I mean, front end for analytics. When I get into that, I'm SQL, I need to show some BI analytics for that structure.
Okay, so there is no preferred way to do it. It usually is the case that the company that starts to use already has a preferred way of doing analytics inside, and that's usually one of the common tools like Tableau, Power BI, Airbnb uses the Superset, I don't think it's a contributor, but there's a wide variety of tools. The important part is that it's just SQL, right? So any tool that talks SQL, you can find it out. Presto, with Starburst drivers and the ODBC compliant tool will talk to it. We have Presto accept from JDBC. So any of those tools integrate very well. So there's not a pattern. I've seen usually there's big companies have their own very specific tools or applications built on top of Presto, or even because Presto accepts ODBC, but at a typical level, it's just a REST endpoint. So a client just needs to talk REST, and many customers of ours and many Presto users implement the tools that throw queries at Presto just to post HTTP post, right? So your mileage will vary.
Question. Thanks a lot for the talk. So cost-based reorganization is super nice in theory, but it's also pretty ugly side to it, and it can go wrong pretty badly as soon as the statistics are not quite as they're supposed to be. And that point's actually pretty easy to read around. I mean, QPCDS doesn't quite get you to that point because it has reasonably benevolent data distributions, but as soon as you go to data sets with having a skewed distributions with like common correlations and so on, because it's extremely hard to the estimates in the time for like city intermediate data sizes and join order optimization, and pretty much everything just becomes almost a wild guess. And this is interestingly something that if you look at some of the, let's say, more traditional database vendors, I think after they spent like 20 years on working on that, a lot of them have taken a step back and tried to say, okay, let's do a little less cost-based field optimization and do a little more, reduce the degrees of freedom for the optimizer and a little bit more robust runtime algorithms that don't rely on too many of the choices and so on. I'm just curious what your personal take on all of this is. Is this something where you don't have with some more, some better data structures that are around right now, some change in the way hardware and database architecture works? This is not as much an issue anymore as it used to be, or
that definitely makes sense. And for example, one of the features, the capping of the broadcast table size is reasons of observations. So we found that when this is a very good example because if you should use broadcast drawings with this color, right? So if you make a mistake and do a broadcast drawing, you pay much more for the error because you multiplicate with complications on the entire cluster and you occupy much more memory. So this flag, for example, allows you to reduce the possibility of that happening because first of all you can cut the size, and then even if an error happens, that usually is not such a big issue because it could be still orders of magnitude, but if you have to change the drawing, it's still not a big deal. We also have a mechanism. Well, initially, CBO had a mechanism for guess estimate. So when we cannot estimate something accurately, we use a guess. Now that changed. So when you cannot estimate something, we just use an unknown and then fall back to the plan that you can provide. So we try to reduce the envelope where the CBO does work. But of course, this is great because it can be found new use cases. But the idea is that we should be really certain that the estimates will help to use the CBO. Of course, down the road, as an investment, but there are some plans for the CBO to implement some kind of histograms for data. Not decided yet how exactly it would look. But even with reducing the cost estimates and limiting the broadcast size, you can get a really good input for basic when reordering. Some of our clients also decide to use just the table statistic so that they get CBO on the lowest level. So for drawings on actual tables without any intermediate appraisals, and then they can also take account for the CBO without wasting rock plans.
All right, thanks much more, Wojciech and Karol.